away from me.
You look awful.
Thanks.
What up, this is Rama Screen, and in the anticipation of sometime other than now arriving in theaters and on digital March 5, I'm here talking with writer-director Dylan McCormick and one of the stars of this new film, Amy Hargreaves. How are you, Dylan and Amy?
Great, how are you?
Good, good, good. Thank you for taking the time. So Dylan, let me start with you with the obvious question. What was the inspiration behind sometime other than now? What made you want to write this story down?
It's a little weird and corny, but it actually first kind of appeared to me in a bit of a dream, a half waking state that happened many, many years ago. I was asleep in my apartment in Brooklyn, and I started waking up, and I was in this kind of weird state, and these images just kept repeating themselves over and over and over again, and I had no idea what they were or where they came from, and nothing like that had ever happened before, and nothing like that has ever happened since. And this went on for what felt like an hour or so. I finally got up, just wrote down what I had been seeing and left it there. And then I kind of moved on, and I actually ended up writing and directing a different film called Four Lane Highway. And then after Four Lane Highway, when I was considering my next project, I just sort of dug up my old notes, and this thing just kept resonating for me. And I just started kind of writing forward from there and trying to figure out who this guy was and what he was all about. And I literally just wrote the next scene and the next scene and the next scene. And before you knew it, he was walking down the road, coming upon a motel. And at the time, I really, to be honest, had no concept that he was, why he was there. And so, very organic process, but you can also get yourself in a lot of trouble that way, because when you don't know where you're headed, you can start to write yourself into a lot of corners that are tough to get out of. So it took a long time after that initial moment to sort of wrangle this thing and rest it down to the ground and figure out what the actual story was.
Dylan, where exactly is the location or the setting? Because as I was watching the film, it's got that welcoming, inviting small town vibe to it. It looked like either the Bay Area or perhaps Santa Barbara. Am I warm there?
Well, it is warmer there than where he actually is.
3,000 miles east.
Yeah. So it had always felt to me actually like it was on the coastline south of Boston, sort of between there and Cape Cod.
East Coast. Mm.
Yes, and I purposely wanted to leave it somewhat vague and non-specific so that it would feel a little bit more universal, which seems to have worked for you. I think the license plates on the car say Massachusetts, but I wanted to be somewhat open-ended. And it was important to me though that there was a sense that he had traveled very far, and it was a significant journey for him on a motorcycle to come find his daughter.
Amy, you look lovely, by the way, this morning.
Thank you. I'm out of sweats.
I concur.
pandemic season 2 has begun. We have some makeup on.
So what drew you to sometime other than now? How did you come upon, or how did you hear about this project, Amy?
So yeah, my manager sent me the script, and I actually put myself on tape. I was in the Bay Area working and got this script and loved. I love working on independent films. It's just my favorite sector. I'm fortunate enough to work across lots of different areas of my industry. But when I get a chance to jump onto a small, meaningful independent film, it's really, I jump at the chance. So I read this, I loved it. I thought it was really fun. Maureen is kind of, it's a little small town story with these little interesting characters that populate this town. And I thought Maureen was a lot of fun and very interesting. I love that it talks about kind of love at midlife and I don't know, it's just a world that, me as an actress at my age, I don't always get to explore characters like this. So, Yeah, and also the bonus was we shot this on the North Fork of Long Island, about a half an hour from where I grew up. So that's kind of my neck of the woods, and it felt like a nice little homecoming to be able to go out there and work for a few days. It was really lovely.
Yes, you play the bartender Maureen, who has a significant interaction with Donald's character Sam. How would you, you touch on this real quick, but how would you describe Maureen? And did you have any bartending experience prior to taking on this role?
No, zero bartending experience. I have experience on the other side of the bar, but that's about it. Maureen is, I think Maureen is like tough, but sensitive. You know, she's a local girl who's, you know, in a relationship, but still kind of, you know, kind of unfulfilled and still looking for love, you know, it's kind of never too late. And I love how her relationship with Donald Logue's character evolves over the course of the film. I feel like it's very respectful and loving in its own way. So I think Maureen's kind of ultimately, you know, very wise.
Back to you, Dylan. Many of my fans are aspiring filmmakers. And of course, generally, you don't jump into big studio blockbuster projects coming out of film schools. What were the challenges of making Sometime Other Than Now independently? Looking back now, were there things that you would have done differently?
You know, that part of the question, nothing is clear to me that I could have actually done differently. I think that it evolved the way that it needed to. It took an extraordinarily long time, both the writing process for me, but also then once I had the script in a place that I felt good about, there were literally, you know, years, maybe up to 5 years of trying to get the script to producers that independent producers and production companies to get them to become interested in producing it and raising money. And, you know, called in a lot of favors from friends to hand the script to various people. And I think that process was long and arduous, but it just had to happen. And the thing that kept me going during that process was everybody that I gave it to just gave extraordinarily lovely feedback and said, we would love to do this. You know, I think it's a very small, it's a story without a significant hook. It doesn't have an edgy concept to it. So I think that it's a challenge to get somebody to commit to a project like this. And then finally, I just was introduced to the producer, Stan Erdrich, and he really responded to it, really loved it, and was able to go out and raise the money. And it was, I literally, you know, one of those things where I was sort of at a point of just thinking, okay, what else might I do with my life before it actually just sort of came together at the end. And then, I don't know. I don't know how it could have been different, but that it was long and hard, but worth it.
Were Kate and Donald your first choices for the role of Kate and Sam?
Yeah, so right after Stan became involved, we started looking around and thinking about Sam's first. And, you know, at first it did not occur to me in a way that when I look back now, it seems ridiculous because he seems so absolutely right. But when I was first thinking about people and making lists, it didn't occur to me. And then one day he popped into my head, and maybe I was too close to him or something, because he made a wonderful movie called The Tao of Steve about 20 years ago that was directed by my sister-in-law, Jennifer Goodman, and co-written by Jennifer and my wife, Greer Goodman. And my wife co-starred with Donald in the movie. And it was a very different role, obviously. It was sort of a very interesting romantic comedy, twist on a romantic comedy. And so it was almost like he was just too close to me, and a very different kind of role. But anyway, he popped into my head and I thought, wait a minute, is it possible that he's just right for this? And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, yep. And then I ended up getting him the script. He really responded to it. I went out to California to meet with him, and we sat across each other, having lunch, and I was looking at him just thinking, oh my God, like, this is it. And he similarly was saying, you know, Dylan, when I got the script, I I started reading, and he said, I was just so moved. And he said, I felt like I was reading about myself. You know, Donald has a very interesting history growing up and born in rural South Texas, and kind of moved around a lot, and not so unlike this guy in that way. So, and then, so once Donald came aboard, we just started thinking about women, and, Kate came aboard right then. We just were a bunch of people, and Kate came, it was like really literally at the last minute. We had already started, once we had Donald, we were off and running, and then Kate came in right after that. So, and the first day of shooting, first of all, I went and met with Kate, and we read through the script, and I just was like, oh my God, this is just, I just feel so unbelievably lucky right now. And that's the feeling I had our first day of shooting. I just, when they started working on their first scene, I just thought, I sort of felt like I had to pinch myself that this was actually happening with them.
Amy, I gotta ask you this, because I've been curious about this ever since I turned drinking legal age. Here's my fun question to you, and maybe you can shed light on this. You know how when we go to Starbucks, we're friendly with the baristas, but we're not like, we don't spill our hearts out to the baristas. What is it about bartenders that people just seem so relaxed unloading their problems to them? Is listening part of the requirement of being a bartender, or is that just in the movies?
No, I absolutely think so. I mean, a good bartender is a, you know, part therapist. And also, you know, the thing that you don't have at Starbucks that you have at a bar is alcohol. So, you know, a drink or two loosens the lips. And yeah, I think it's kind of a fascinating world, the world of bars and the people who hang out there and bartenders. It's an interesting thing to consider. I mean, we haven't been able to do that so much lately, but a great bartender absolutely has to be part therapist.
I will also tell you, I did work as a bartender for over 10 years.
And you can attest to that.
Yes.
And finally, for both of you, what do you hope the audiences would take away from the themes of Sometime Other Than Now, this heartwarming film about new love and mending old wounds? What do you hope the audiences would take away from that? Let's start with you, Amy.
Well, I think that it would be nice if the audience took away the idea that it's never too late. It's never too late. And you know, we've all screwed up. We've all done crazy things in our lives. And you might find yourself, you know, at a dead end and think, okay, well, I've screwed up now. But you know what? It's never too late. You can always kind of go back and restart relationships or mend old problems. And
yes, I would say that all of that would be lovely. And, I think for me, and again, it's not necessarily as I'm writing is not what I'm thinking about, but I think there's something about this story and these characters that relates to the idea that relationships and love and are full of challenges and difficulty, but that it doesn't mean they're not worth it. And part of what is needed sometimes is to understand that and accept that, and then to recommit to them. It's not always just this perfect thing, that these things can require work, but that it's a good work to do.
All right, for my fans at home, everybody go check out Sometime Other Than Now, arriving in theaters and on digital March 5. Dylan and Amy, thank you for talking to me, and congratulations.
Thanks so much.
Thanks a lot for having us.
Not away from it.
You look awful.
Thanks.